आई एम डॉक्टर रजनीश, बीटेक, एमटेक एंड पीएचडी इन मैकेनिकल इंजीनियरिंग। डिस्पाइट ऑफ हैविंग प्योर मैकेनिकल इंजीनियरिंग बैकग्राउंड, आई हैव ग्रेट इंटरेस्ट इन द एरिया ऑफ बायो एनर्जी, और यू कैन से वेस्ट टू एनर्जी और रिन्यूएबल एनर्जी। समटाइम्स आई थिंक ऑफ द नेचर एंड द मोस्ट ब्यूटिफुल प्लैनेट ऑफ आवर सोलर सिस्टम, आवर मदर अर्थ। It has given us all essential things to survive easily, but because of our vested interests, we are continuously and progressively exploiting all the natural resources and the nature itself. So I decided to work in the area of green energy while implementing the concepts of engineering and technology. After all, energy is as important as blood for a human body to survive. Energy can be generated using renewable sources, which are freely available all around. Energy is in the air, in the water, in the sunlight, and even in the waste we create in our households, in industries, in hospitals, and everywhere. The thing is to apply the best of technology to utilize these renewable sources without harming the nature. In fact, handling the huge waste has become a challenge for almost every municipality. The waste not only affects the health of living beings, but also has harmful effects on our environment and ecology. So let's begin with the session on introduction to bioenergy technologies. Welcome to the session on introduction to bioenergy technologies. Let's begin with some statistics on availability of biomass in India. According to a report of Ministry of New and Renewable Energy, Government of India, around 500 metric tons of biomass is available per year, and with this available biomass, around 17,500 megawatts of electricity can be produced. And this can be understood with the help of this demograph. So most of the states in India are having good potential. So we can have a look over these statistics. So we can have a look over the world demograph also. US and Brazil are the largest producer of biofuel based on the biomass. In Asia also, China is also at a good level. Whereas India, despite of having good potential, India is not utilizing the biomass resources. So now coming to the main roots of the conversion of biomass into useful energy. So basically there are three routes of conversion. First is the thermochemical conversion, second is the biochemical conversion, and third is the chemical conversion. In thermochemical conversion, it is based on the pyrolysis or the gasification. So the useful gas is generated with the help of this pyrolysis, and the gas is known as syngas and or producer gas. So this producer gas can be combusted in the engines directly to produce the electricity or to get some mechanical work. So application could be anyone. Second route is the biochemical conversion. So this is basically anaerobic digestion or fermentation to convert the biomass into biogas. So this we'll discuss in detail in the subsequent slides. Third one is the chemical conversion. This is basically the biofuel production. So this is based on the transesterification. The main process is the esterification and or transesterification. So let's have a look over the flexibility of gasification. So in the first route, the gasification, we have the gas. Sometimes it has good medium heating value gas, or sometimes we get low heating value gas depending upon the type of feedstock we are using. So if we are having medium heating value gas, it can be used to run the turbine, gas turbine, and we can generate the electricity directly. Or after synthesis of this medium heating value gas, we can convert this gas into these alcohol based fuels. And thirdly, we can directly run the engine on this gas along with diesel, conventional fuel. So we can generate the electricity also through this route. And secondly, we have the low heating value gas. It can be used directly in the engine to produce the electricity.
एंड ऑफ कोर्स द परसेंटेज ऑफ द डीजल वुड बी मोर इन दिस केस एज द गैस इज हैविंग लो हीटिंग वैल्यू. सो सेकेंड रूट मे बी यूटिलाइजिंग द लो हीटिंग वैल्यू गैस इन द बॉयलर्स टू प्रोड्यूस इलेक्ट्रिसिटी और द प्रोसेस स्टीम वट एवर द एप्लीकेशन इज. Thirdly, we can produce ammonia with the help of this low heating value gas after synthesis. So this much is the huge flexibility of gasification process. Now coming to the second route, that is the biogas or bio digestion or the bio fermentation or biogas production, whatever the name you may give. Sometimes it is known as bio CNG. Or it is also known as compressed biogas. So there are so many names given to the process and technology. So the biogas is basically used primarily as a cooking fuel, and of course biogas production nowadays is having good interest and potential in waste management. So most of the municipalities, they are facing huge problem in the waste management. So it has a good role also. Like segregation is the main challenge. If the waste is recepted in segregated form, it can be utilized in the conversion of this waste into biogas. So biogas has so many applications. So it can be used as a cooking fuel. It can be used as a automotive fuel after of course upgradation. Upgradation means the scrubbing out of unwanted gases in the biogas. So this we'll understand in the subsequent slides. So it is much like a natural gas. Biogas is basically like a natural gas, and the main composition of the biogas is methane. It is having 40 to 75%. Carbon dioxide is ranging from 25 to 55%. Ammonia ranges from 0 to 1%. It is in the trace amount only. Oxygen is ranging from 0 to 1%. Water is 0 to 10%. Hydrogen sulfide H2S is 1 to 3%. Nitrogen is 0 to 5%. Hydrogen is 0 to 1%. So the ranges are specified. So the particular value will depend upon the so many parameters or the factors, like what are the conditions inside the digester. So we are mainly focusing on the methane. We are more concerned on the methane. So larger the quantity of methane in the biogas, larger better will be the biogas yield. So we need to scrub out these unwanted gases. These are very harmful gases, CO2 and H2S, and even ammonia also. So they need to be scrubbed out before bottling the biogas, so that it can be used in the automotives. And water is also required to be removed out. So there are so many processes to scrub out these unwanted gases and water. So let's understand how the biogas is produced. It is basically produced by the breakdown of organic waste by bacteria without oxygen. So it is known as anaerobic digestion. Anaerobic means in the process which is happening in the absence of air. So what types of organic waste could be turned into biogas? Any organic waste can be converted into biogas. The thing is that the feedstock should be organic in nature. So biogas is made by fermenting organic waste in a biodigester. This is just a scheme to understand. This is the biodigester main unit, and this is the displacement tank, and the slurry can be supplied to the digester, and the slurry is fermented inside the digester, and the gas is produced here, and it can be utilized in the house. And the digestate is being displaced with the fresh charge, and the digestate is displaced in the displacement tank, which acts as a fertilizer or the manure. So the size of the digester vary from small household systems to a large commercial plants of several thousand cubic meters. So this is a layout of a complete plant for anaerobic digestion and composting. So in this process we are having two products. One is the main product, that is biogas, and second is the byproduct, that is the cow manure or sub manure or the compost that can be used in the crops or agriculture. So that is the beauty of this process. Everything is useful, nothing is waste. So the plant can be understood with the help of this layout. So this is the elevation, this is side view, and this is the isometric view. So initially the waste is recepted in the reception area, then it is processed in the process modules. Sometimes it has to be segregated, sometimes it has to be mechanically pre-treated, sometimes it has to be chemically pre-treated, sometimes it has to be thermally pre-treated, depending upon the condition of the feedstock. Then it is supplied to the reactor tanks where the process happens, and we get the useful product as a biogas. And then it is going to the maturation boxes where we'll ensure that there is no gas remaining inside the digestate. Then it has to be segregated or screened, the compost is screened, and finally we'll get two products. One is the biogas, second is the compost. So this is the general scheme, and this is the main process of biodigestion, what is happening inside the digester. So initially the feedstock we are supplying to the digester is having carbohydrates, fats, and proteins. So they are converted into sugars, fatty acids, and amino acids during this phase. This phase is known as hydrolysis. In second phase, that is known as hydrogenesis, these sugars, fatty acids, and amino acids are converted into carbonic acids and alcohols, and hydrogen, carbon dioxide, and ammonia. And during third phase, that is known as acetogenesis, these are converted into hydrogen, acetic acid, and carbon dioxide. Finally, we get the methanogenesis phase, where we get the our main product, that is methane and carbon dioxide. So this phase is known as methanogenesis. So collectively, all the phases are known as HRT, which is known as hydraulic retention time. So this is the process which happens inside the biodigester tank. Initially, that this is the initial phase, and this is the final phase where we are getting the biogas. So this HRT, the time for which this our slurry spend in the digester, it depends upon multiple factors. So how long will it take to have the maximum biogas out of the supplied feedstock? So these are the factors on which this affect, the parameters which are affecting the anaerobic digestion. First is the temperature. This is the most important parameter. So we have classified the zones in three zones, basically. Saccharophilic zone, where it is not recommended to employ the biodigester plant, because at temperature below 20 or 25 degrees C, it is not recommended. We have to additionally supply the heat to the digester, which is economically not possible. So generally we prefer the mesophilic zone, where temperature ranges from 25 to 55 degrees C. So that is the best range, and most of the parts in India is having this much temperature. Then we have the thermophilic zone, which is beyond 55 degrees C. So these are the temperature zones or ranges. Second important parameter is the pH. So anaerobic digestion process is pH dependent, and the working range is 6.4 to 7.8, and for having the better production, the pH should be stabilized inside the digester. So stabilizing the pH can be done with the help of various methods, like we can inoculate some chemicals and we can supply some organic matters also to maintain the pH. Third is the HRT. This is the time for which material spends in the digester. So for wet digestion it ranges from 30 to 50 days. Again, this depends on these things, other things, rest of the things. Next is the CN, the ratio of carbon to nitrogen. So some essential nutrients for the bacterial growth, the ratio has to be maintained from 20 to 1. Next is the dry matter. So dry matter is basically the amount of solid content present in the paste, and in generally we use cow dung as a main feedstock material. So it the dry matter content ranges from 2 to 15% in case of cow dung. So other feedstocks, they are having different ranges of dry matter. Next one is the feed rate. This is the amount of organic waste fed per unit volume to the digester. So this also depends on the volume of the digester we are using. So these are the factors upon which the anaerobic digestion depends. Now these are the raw materials for biogas production. So this is a huge classification. So we have animal dung, these are the dungs basically, and these are the grasses, and these are the hospital waste, these are the forest waste, these are also forest waste. We have huge potential in all the organic waste, so we can have a look over the demograph. These are the tested substrates already proven. So sometimes particular feedstock, suppose this is maize silage, this is having good biogas production, but in this produced biogas, this is in meter cube per ton, and the methane content is mentioned here. Only 52% of the methane is we have got in this particular feedstock. Sometimes you can have a look over this particular feedstock. This is pressed pulp. So though the biogas yield is less, but the quantity of methane is very good. So this can be understood. So many feedstocks are already tested, and even the co-digestions are also tested. So many research is going on over the co-digestion, means the combination of one and two, or two or more. So recent articles, research articles can be referred to have a look over the research articles on co-digestion. So at NIT Kurukshetra, we have developed a lab level facility, experimental facility. And this is just a schematic diagram to understand the process. So this is a digester having two necks. One neck is employed with data acquisition system and digital pH meter probe. And another neck is provided with stirrer, which is motorized stirrer, basically stepper motor control. So gas is produced. This pipe is also employed in this neck. So where we are getting the biogas produced out of this digester. So mechanical stirring is also required to have the uniform mixture and to break the scum produced over the slurry. Upper layer we have scum produced over the slurry. So it has to be dissolved inside the slurry with the help of mechanical stirrer. So it is basically a motorized stirrer. And you can see this is the motorized stirrer, and it is programmed basically in 1 hour. Rotation is given for 1 minute and at 15 rpm. So very slowly we have tried to maintain the rpm. So the gas is produced and it can be stored in these gas holders. So these are the gas holders. So three digesters are there, one, two, and three. So this is a small bathtub. This is the big bathtub where two biodigesters are employed, and this bathtub we are having one digester. So pH meters are also there, three pH meters are there to monitor the in situ pH inside the slurry. And likely we have the main component, main equipment, that is biogas analyzer, through which we can observe how much is the biogas and what are the constituents of the biogas being produced in the different digesters. So this is all about the experimental facilities. So not only the lab level facility we have the working unit also. So this is the working unit where we are generating the biogas and utilizing the biogas to run this non-conventional air conditioning system. So this is a project under Science and Engineering Research Board, Government of India project. It is sponsored by Government of India. Now coming to the types of biogas plants. So there are basically three types of biogas plants used for the production of biogas. These are fixed dome type of biogas plant. Second is floating gas type of floating gas holder type of biogas plant. Third is bag type of biogas plants. So we can understand the working of fixed dome type of biogas plants. As the name suggests, the dome is fixed and the slurry is supplied through this channel, inlet chamber, and the digestate is being displaced with the fresh charge to the overflow tank, and the gas is produced here and it can be taken out through this vent. So the construction is very simple, and this is known as constant volume type of biogas plant, as the volume inside the digester is always constant. Next are the benefits of fixed dome type of biogas plant. The cost of this type of plant is relatively low, and it is simple in construction as there are no moving parts, and there is no rusting and steel plants parts, and hence life of this plant is long, around 20 years can be expected easily. And the plant is constructed underground, protecting it from physical damage and saving space also. Next is the floating drum type of biogas plant. As the name suggests, the drum floats over the main digester. So this floating drum acts as a gas holder. So this is not a fixed volume, this is rather known as fixed constant pressure biogas plant. So pressure, ultimately we are having the constant pressure inside the holder, so to get the continuous supply of the biogas. So rest of the construction is same. The difference is of this biogas holder, which is floating type. And the benefits of this type of plant is this plant is easy to understand and operate, and it is a constant pressure plant, and the stored gas volume is immediately recognizable by the position of the drum. So the position of the drum indicates the quantity of the biogas produced. Third is the gas, this bag type of biogas plant. This is manufactured of high strength PVC polyester fabric, and it is more efficient, and there are no chances of leakage. So there are so many different types of biogas plants, and these are the biogas plants with movable gas holders. These are the fixed dome type, and these are the digester and gas holder separately. And the digester is deployed at some other place, and the holder is being connected with the pipe and placed at some other place. So fourth one is the flexible bag plant. So these are the some designs, like KVIC is the Khadi and Village Industries Commission. Likely we there are so many organizations which work only on the production of biogas plants dedicatedly. They are designing different types of biogas plants, and they have christened them according to their organization names. So you can have a look of so many types of biogas plants. These are the four main types of biogas plants used in India. This is Janta fixed dome type. This is the design, KVIC design, floating drum. And third is the Deen Bandhu fixed dome. And fourth one is Shramik Bandhu biogas plant. So we can quickly have a look over these types of plants. You just pause the video and go into the detail of these types of biogas plants. The basic things we already have discussed with the help of schematic diagrams. So this is Khadi and Village Industries Commission design. So the details, you can have a look over these details of this particular design. This is Deen Bandhu type of plant. You can go through the details. And this is the design by Murugappa Chettiar Research Center, MCRC. So these are the details. So this is just a comparison of KVIC design and Astra. Astra is again an organization, application of science and technology for rural areas. So you can have a look over this comparison on these parameters. For constructing a biogas digester, we need to have these five sections. First is the mixing tank, which presents above the ground level. Second is the inlet tank. Then is the digester. Then comes outlet tank. Overflow tank is required. And we have some feedstocks tested. And these are the tested values. So some of the examples are there. So although so many other raw materials have been tested, so these are just the examples, just to refer. Now comes to the utilization of biogas. Its major application is in cooking. So 2 cubic meter of the biogas plant is sufficient to provide cooking fuel needs for family of about 5 persons. So this calculation we'll try to understand in the subsequent slides. Next is the lighting. Biogas can be used in silk mantle lamps for lighting purposes, and this much is the requirement. This also we'll try to understand with some example. And for power generation, as I already mentioned, after scrubbing out the unwanted gases, we can store it and we can run the engine also. So it is much like the compressed natural gas. So it is known as bio CNG or compressed biogas, CBG. So we can use it as a transport fuel also after removing the unwanted gases. So these are the other benefits of biogas. Availability of power at affordable rates. So since we are utilizing the waste only to convert into useful energy, so the power production will be of relatively low cost. The pollution will be reduced. The pollution created by the waste, which is like freely deployed at many places, so which creates the greenhouse gases, which contributes to the greenhouse gases and which creates the pollution also. So that can be reduced with the help of using this technology. Next is the reduced time waste while collecting firewood. So this is the point basically for rural people. Those who are cooking their food with the help of these firewoods only. Reduce reliance on fossil fuels. Though the fossil fuels are having limited quantity or availability, they are depleting at alarming rate, so we can reduce the reliance on fossil fuels. It saves on environment, also reduces deforestation. So many parameters are there, like it reduces deforestation, it reduces firewood collection time, and it helps to improve the living standard in rural areas, reduce global warming. It produces good quality enriched manure to improve soil fertility. As I already mentioned, the byproduct of the process is the enriched manure. Next is the effective and convenient way for sanitary disposal of organic waste, improving the hygiene conditions. So this is the major challenge in villages. You may find, once you enter the village, you will find that you have entered a village. So that can be rooted out with the help of this biogas technology. If all of the waste of any village is utilized in conversion of bio waste into biogas, so ultimately we'll have the hygienic conditions in the villages also. Not only villages, our urban areas, we are facing too much problem in waste management, so there also the plants can be employed. So as a smokeless domestic fuel, it reduces the incidence of eyes and lung diseases. This is again for the rural people. So these are the requirements for a 5 meter cube plant. So just pause the video and have a look over this. What are the things required to fabricate a 5 cubic meter plant having floating drum type of biogas plant? Now this is energy calculation of biogas plant, just a formula to calculate the total biogas production. So for cattle, maximum gas production per kilogram is around 0.05 meter cube. So total gas will be the total dung in kilograms multiplied by this factor 0.05. this is the meter cube per kilogram. Okay, so calculation for 4 animals, suppose there are 4 animals available and each is producing 8 kilograms of dung, so we are having 32 kilograms of dung. So multiplying with this factor, we'll have this much of biogas, 1.6 meter cube by 4 animals. So 1 meter cube corresponds to around 19 megajoule of energy. So multiplying it with the available produced biogas, so we are having this much energy out of 4 animal dung. So if we convert it into kilowatt hours, so we'll have 8.3 kilowatt hours easily with the help of 4 animal dungs. Now conversion to electricity energy. Around 65% of energy is lost as heat and other losses, mechanical losses, if we run the electrical generator with biogas. So we are left with 35% only. So 8.3 was the generated kilowatt hour by 4 animals, and we are now left with only 2.9 watt kilowatt hour of electrical energy from 32 kilogram of cow dung. So for 2 bulbs of 60 watts and 1 fan of 80 watt, they can run for 12 hours easily on 2.91 kilowatt hour electrical energy. So this is just an calculation. Now calculation for cooking. So medium stove uses 9 megajoule of energy per hour. So for manure of 3 animals, and we have to run the stove for 2.5 hours. We try to understand with the help of this calculation. So these are the three animals. Each is producing 8 kilograms of dung. So we are having 24 kilograms of dung, and it corresponds to 1.2 meter cube of biogas. So 1.2 into 19 megajoule of energy will have 22.8 megajoule per 9. So this we are having 2.5 hours. That is the time we can run this medium stove with the 24 kilograms of cow dung. Now coming to the gasification, as I already mentioned, the gasification can be done with the help of a gasifier. The gasifier basically is a system where the partial combustion of the dry organic waste is done at around 1000 degree C of temperature. So during gasification, air to fuel proportion varies between 1.5:1 to 1.8:1, which is less than ideal air to fuel proportion, which ranges from 6:1 to 6.5:1. So the products of gasification are combustible gases like carbon monoxide, hydrogen, and traces of methane and non-useful products like tar and dust. The reactor in which gasification process takes place is called a gasifier. Now this is these are the basically processes involved in the gasification. First is the drying, and accordingly the zones are specified in the gasifier: the drying zone, pyrolysis zone, combustion zone, and then the reduction zone. So these are the four processes which happens in the gasification. So how the gasification efficiency can be calculated? So suppose we are working with some type of feed stock. So we know the heating value of that particular feed stock. Suppose walnut shells are there. So we know the calorific value of that walnut shell. We can calculate or measure with the help of bomb calorimeter. So it is multiplied with the yield, means how much quantity is produced of the producer gas, then over the total heating value multiplied by 100. So this way we can calculate the gasification efficiency. Likely the heating value can be obtained via this expression. So A into heating value of methane, these are the constituents of the producer gas: methane, CO, and H2. Okay, so these are the three constituents. So A into heating value of this, B into heating value of this, C into heating value of this over 100. So these are the A, B, C are the percentages of methane, CO, and H2 present in the producer gas. So this way we can work out the gasification efficiency or heating value basically. So these are the heating values, these are the constituents of the producer gas: methane, CO, and H2. These are the experimentally tested values. So coming to the classification of the gasifiers, so basically they are classified into two types: fixed bed and fluidized bed. In fixed bed we have cross draft, down draft, up draft. So we at NIT Kurukshetra are having down draft type of gasifier. And in fluidized bed we have bubbling bed and circulating bed. So the schematics are there. You can understand the process with the help of suppose this is the downdraft. So biomass is supplied through this hopper. This conical shape is supplied, given there. So through this hopper the feedstock is supplied to the drying zone. So after drying there is a pyrolysis, and air is coming from these sides. This is the oxidation zone. So there is basically the combustion zone, where we are partially combusting or burning the feedstock. Then this is the reducing zone. So finally we are having the producer gas after getting this producer gas at this point, we have to filter this producer gas through various filters. So that is the separate process, so likely depending upon the flow of air in the digester, gasifier. We have other two types of plants. This is the upper draft, and this is the post draft. So this is the schematic diagram of gasifier, downdraft gasifier, which is available at NIT Kurukshetra. So this is the main plant, main gasifier unit. This is the gasifier. Then we have the coarse, after a gas is produced, producer gas is produced, we have the coarse filter. Then there is a venturi, and then there is a test layer. This is a test layer, so we can observe the flame, like whether we are getting the combustible gas producing out of this gasifier or not. So we can check through this layer. So these are the other things, like the after filtration, final filter is the fabric filter, and finally we are getting the producer gas at this point, and this is supplied to the engine, which is controlled with the help of this control panel and data logger. So finally we are getting the mechanical power out of this engine using the producer gas produced in this gasifier along with the diesel. So diesel is also supplied to the engine through this tank. The rest is the supporting arrangement, you can understand with the help of this schematic diagram. And this is the actual system, downdraft gasifier available at NIT Kurukshetra, 40 kilowatt electrical power capacity. So these are the things which we have understood with the help of a schematic diagram in the previous slide. This is the gasifier. The feedstock is supplied at this point in this upper shell, and the producer gas is being filtered in coarse filter. Then through venturi it is going to the test layer, where we can see the layer of the producer gas. Then we have fine filter, and then finally we have fabric filter. So this pipe is directly going to the engine, which is coming out here, and it is supplied to the engine along with diesel. So we are getting mechanical power finally, which can be measured with the help of this dynamometer, eddy current dynamometer. So all the things can be visualized here in the computer, like the performance of the engine, like P theta curve or PV curve we can observe here, and other parameters also. We can apply the load, we can check the performance of the engine, and we can see the emission analysis. We can observe the emission analysis of the engine using this producer gas along with diesel. These are the other equipment, supporting equipments. This is the gas analyzer used to measure the constituents of the producer gas. This is the exhaust gas analyzer used to do the emission analysis of the engine, which was operated with the producer gas produced with the help of dry waste, organic waste. And these are the other facilities available at NIT Kurukshetra. You can have a look over these systems, and the more details are given at the website of NIT Kurukshetra under Research and Consultancy tab. So thank you very much. These are my details, you can contact me.